Hey, hello everyone. My name is Jeffrey. Once again, thank you for joining us this evening in our Global Reach series. We hope that you are having a relaxed time. It's a Saturday evening. Thank you that you are here. We always welcome you to join us week after week as we always bring to you different programs, different series to help you pertaining to your tertiary education. Okay, now, as usual, week after week, we have always come here to remind you all where you are right now. If you are watching us through the Study Hub Facebook or through JS Study Solutions Facebook or even UWE Bristol Malaysia Facebook, okay, don't forget to like the Facebook there. Okay, don't forget to share out tonight's session about study in UK. Wow, study in UK. Don't forget to share this streaming now. Okay, we are doing it live. It's about an hour show. All right. Now, don't forget also to put comments as the program is approximately about an hour. We will be allowing you, we welcome you to ask questions in regarding to study in UK, study in UWE Bristol. Okay, our partner this evening, Ken. Okay, so do that. Relax. Hope that you have fun. And if you have any other series, any other universities, any other countries, regardless where they are, if you want us to bring to you, do let us know. Look out for July. Look out for August. We're going to have more. We have planned out some of the programs for you already. And we're going to bring it down to you very, very soon in the week to come. All right? Can do that. Okay, remember to like our Facebooks. And tonight, like I mentioned again, we are talking about Global Reach, and Global Reach series tonight is Study in UK. Study in UK has been a fantastic opportunity to many students, not only just Malaysian, but also around the world. You know, I have friends who have already graduated from UK over the many years. I've got students who are still going to UK right now. I've got students applying to us who are going to UK, and it is definitely a country, you know, worthwhile for you to understand, for you to know the opportunities that you will be getting from. Okay, and specifically tonight, we are speaking to UWE Bistro. Okay, UWE, or they call it UWE Bistro, is our partner. Okay, they are our a good partner. They have been working with us for 1, 2, 3 years now. And let me bring the speaker up to the screen. Can we get the guest speaker?
Hi, Jeffrey. Hi, good evening.
Hey, hi
everyone. Tina. How are you?
Hello. We are all good. We are all good. And we hope that you are doing well yourself, Phoenix.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm doing very well here. Yeah, so it's a Saturday night. And then yeah, everyone should be chill and relaxed.
That's right. So you make sure you chill and relax. How has the MCO got into you? Are you get used to it already? You are doing all right with it?
Well, the MCO, just like anyone else, that we have been working from home since March 18. Life has been so busy. Juggling everything, and apart from work, then we also juggling our families and kids' educations and whatnot. We've been doing different things as a team. So we learn to do different things, like you know, session like this as well.
Yeah.
So it's fantastic. Also, you know, part of things. And yeah, we're now going back to the office on a rotation basis.
Cool.
So like 3 days in the office and 2 days work from home. So yeah, I think this will be a new normal life for many of us.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Okay. Now, everyone who are with us this evening, we have together with us Miss Phoenix. Miss Phoenix is now the International Recruitment Manager. Yes, she is not in UK. She is based in Malaysia. They have an office in Malaysia in PJ. And I will just get her to introduce herself again to you all. And before we ask her some questions, tonight's session will be more like a Q&A section. You know, we're going to ask her about studying UK, studying in Bristol, and studying UWE. So as you go along the presentation, if you've got any questions, please feel free to ask her, and we'll come to you as the time allows. Okay, Phoenix, go ahead and introduce yourself, and then you can also start with telling us why we should choose to study in UK.
Right. Thanks, Jeffrey. Thanks, everyone, for having me tonight. As I mentioned earlier, this is a Saturday evening. Let's make it a relaxed evening. And I mean, I will be actually sharing with you about, you know, the advantages of study in the UK, and then a bit about my university, the kind of courses that we could offer. But in the meantime, if you have any questions, you know, feel free to actually you know, type in your Facebook, you know, just ask, and then we, Jeffrey and I, will try our every possible to answer to your question. So just to quickly, you know, do a quick introduction of myself. I'm Phenix. In fact, I was born in Seremban, where Jeffrey's company is.
Yes.
And miss all the,
my
you know,
home food.
Yes. And then I was born and bred there. And then I pursue my tertiary educations. And then the first job that I was actually landed in was education sector. I think I was actually supposed, I got two jobs offer, one of which was the bank industry, and the other one is actually education industry. And I chose the education industry as an education counselor with another company, and never looked back, and ever since. And I'm not going to tell you how old I am now, Jeffrey. over the last tech decade, I would say, I've been assisting and helping hundreds and hundreds of students every year, together with my team, in helping them in, you know, to search for the right course and assist them to study abroad, especially to the UK, and then also to UWE Bristol, for many of the courses. So that's what I've been doing. That's a short introduction of myself.
No worries. The way you put it, you know, I agree with you. So many students are still looking at UK, to study. And I'm sure that you must have got many other reasons why they choose UK.
Yeah, there have been surveys actually been done officially by different organizations amongst Malaysian students. And UK always has been top the list, that being the most favored country to study abroad. In fact, 50% of the students would actually, you know, feedback that if by every possible, they like to have a year abroad, and that will be UK. So it remains as one of the most popular countries, followed by others like Australia, Singapore, US.
Definitely. So why UK? So tell us why UK.
Right. I have somehow prepared some slides to show you. Is that okay for me to put it on the screen, Jeff?
Please go ahead.
Yeah?
Please go ahead.
Okay. Just give me a minute. So. Just a second.
No worries.
Okay, right. Can you see the slide?
Yep.
All right. So it's on my screen right now. I can't see myself. Yep. Except this picture. My colleague has touched up nicely for me. Obviously this was after touch up, thanks to my lovely colleague Wyman. Okay. Right. Just to give everyone some introductions about where we are. That's Malaysia. I'm sure you know where we are, Malaysia. Mm-hmm. And then the arrow actually pointing to the UK. This from Malaysia flying to the UK, it's just 13 hours away. Direct flight, Malaysia Airlines, British Airways. So it's more than 10,000 kilometers away. Far from home,
not too far, still within the map.
Yes, so you still can reach from Malaysia and do a day trip to the UK and fly back. So if you want it's not as bad. So Malaysia is actually 7 to 8 hours ahead of UK, so it's not still not so bad, in a sense, like, you know, in 4 o'clock in the UK, 4 o'clock Malaysia time is the UK 9 o'clock, and that's not so we can still like communicate with each other and your family. Yeah, it's not so bad. And then just a brief introduction. And the UK, it's actually like composed of four big countries, as if four big countries. We always hear about England, and then we actually they are consists of four continents, like Wales, right. Northern right. Ireland, and Scotland as well. So these actually make the whole UK. Okay. And then so jumped into your questions that you asked, why students generally choose UK. So I mean, as you can see that on the screen itself, some very famous universities are in the UK. I don't have to name them because you know them, who they are. They start with O and they start with C. Oxford, Cambridge, you know. And then in amongst the top 100 university, 18 are actually UK institutions. And then with the more than 50 world leaders, the top persons, leaders in the world, they received British education in the past. So, and also there was a survey among international graduates, meaning to say that students who graduate from a UK education, 83% of them actually responded saying that their qualifications, the educations they received from the UK actually helped them to get to land on a better job.
I have a friend in the UK who is working there, registered in the UK and study there. I mean, study there and registered there and now working there as a pharmacist.
Right. Yeah, in fact, some of our friends, family members, you know, it is not unusual that we hear our friends and relatives or family members actually, you know, work in the UK, for example. And also, just last year, the UK government has actually revived the graduate route, the post-study work visa, whereby if you complete a degree in the UK, from this year onwards, you join a degree, you complete a degree or a master's degree by next year, you will be able to stay on in the UK for 2 years to look for a job. So
that was what I wanted to ask you as well, also to clarify, you know, because of this 2 years post study. So it is possible now because of the change in the government policy, right, since last year?
Yeah, it was actually announced last year. So then this year onwards, students actually joined the program this year. Let's say they are coming for the final year and complete the degree or a master's degree. They are eligible to apply for the graduate route 2 years post-study work visa.
This is definitely a very fantastic encouragement news to students to study in UK. Definitely
Exactly. Yeah, it can be a full-time job. It can be a part-time job. Any job, or within that 2 years, you can still search for any jobs. So this can be you know, a plus when you come to consider study abroad. Right. So moving on, this is just a, you know, give you some ideas about progression routes to the UK. You know, there's let's say currently you are doing your SPM, your IG or year 11, then moving on, you need to have a foundation or A levels or pre-university or some kind, and then embark on a British degree. A British degree usually is 3 years. Okay, generally it's about 3 years, honours degree, and then finish with a master's degree, which usually will be a 1 year or 2 years. But generally it's about like 12 months. And of course, on completions of a master's, if you want to pursue a PhD, then PhDs will be ranged from 3 years to a maximum to 5 years. General intake for UK, would be in September every year.
That's right.
And then the smaller intake will be in January. So certain courses do actually offer in January, like master's degrees and some of the popular courses probably will actually offer in January, but generally it's actually autumn intake. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Right. Okay. Yeah, Jeff, I actually can only see my screen with the slides, you know, so I couldn't actually get those like questions. So you remind me.
Don't worry. If there are questions, I will just remind you.
Yeah, no problem. Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Not yet got questions yet.
No questions. Okay.
Not yet.
So
this is an interesting one.
Money matters, especially.
Yeah, money always matters.
Exactly. So I mean, this is just a general an average of, I mean, it varies from institutions to institutions, from courses to courses, but this is just an average of kind of like tuition fees. That are foundations in the UK or a bachelor degree in the UK or a master's degree in the UK actually are charging. Mm-hmm. And then the conversions is actually based on, like, you know, the currency of like a pound to a 5 ringgit 30 cents or something like that. Yeah. And it's estimate of tuition fees per year. Okay. Right. So and the total cost of study in the UK, I'm using the tuition fees and living costs of my study in my university as a benchmark. So so it depends on the kind of universities and the fees they are charging, really. So in, when it comes to budgeting, okay? So the tuition fees that my university is charging per year is 13,500. Per year, and this is exclude any kind of discount or scholarships, and plus the living costs, which include the accommodation, you know, personal expenses, transportations, miscellaneous, and etc. So that comes to an estimation of 23,500 per year per academic year.
Yeah. Actually, you know, the way I look at it, it's not too bad. I mean, if you're talking about 130,000, I think it's bearable. And anyway, I mean, since we are in this living expenditure, students are allowed to work part-time during their study, right, Phoenix?
Yeah, international students, you are allowed to actually work part-timely or not more than 20 hours during term time. Okay, and that has been all this while. However, recently, due to the COVID situation in the UK, the government has actually allowed tier four students to work unlimited hours. So I think this is in support of a lot of the pharmacy students. They are actually doing voluntary work in the NHS, in the hospital setting. So they have actually allowed the international students to actually work more than 20 hours. There's no limit in terms of time. So they can work more than 20 hours.
That's good. At least that would help them out a bit on the living expenses where they are. How about if a student who wants to prepare themselves to apply to UK, you know, what, how will you advise them? You know,
Right, that's the next slide that I'm going to share with everyone. Yeah. So generally, to apply to a degree course in the UK or a UK university especially, it's through this UCAS, UCAS, that you might have heard of. It's University and Colleges Admission Services. It's a website, okay? You just need to actually register and sign up and pay a £25 fees, which I think in ringgit is about like 100 plus ringgit fees, and then you can apply to a maximum of 5 university for the degree and the university of your choice. So this is a centralized online application system, okay? Generally, this is, you know, the UCAS has been a platform for students to apply to British University. However, you can, as a student, if you know that you want to go to a certain university, for example, I want to go to A universities, and then you know that this, for example, Jazz Education, Jeffrey, has been a representative for that university, you can actually make a direct application to the university via Jazz Education. They give you free consultation, they help you A to Z, including visa, and the same fee that you're paying directly to the university. So you're not disadvantaged of by getting the service of JS Education. You can submit a direct application rather than going through the UCAS.
Okay.
So UCAS is not the only platform to apply to a university per se. However, there are certain university, they are very, they just want to deal with UCAS application. So you have no choice but to submit in your application through UCAS. So it depends on university.
But UWE has no issue. They can come direct to you, huh?
Yes. We work with, you can apply to UWE through UCAS, not a problem.
Yeah.
And still, getting JS Education to assist you, not a problem as well. Or you can actually apply directly to UWE Bristol without going through the UCAS application system. That is absolutely fine as well. Okay?
Sure.
Right. Some important dates for UCAS application. I mentioned earlier on that most of the courses actually starting in autumn, like September intake. Therefore, there are certain dates that you need to be mindful of when you make a UCAS application. For example, if a student's actually applying for like medicine, dentistry, WET, or they apply to the very famous high-ranked university like Oxford, Cambridge, then they will have to apply a year earlier. Okay, say like you don't want to join the September 2020 intake, then you have to submit in your UCAS application a year earlier, September last year. And then certain university also do have their deadlines as well. And then the last date for the UCAS application for that designated year of entry is actually on the 30th June, which is coming soon, a few days later. Yeah.
That's right.
Okay.
I got that. I want to ask what are some of the things that should prepare themselves if they want to apply for the visa, what they need to do.
Okay, so when they want to make an application, generally, as I mentioned earlier, you need to sign up the UCAS form, you fill in the UCAS or the direct application form. These are just some of the supporting documents like passport, personal statement. Personal statement is why you want to join this course. What inspire you to join this course? What is what do you want to become? Who do you want to become? For your career aspiration, do you have a career plan? That's all. So basically, to understand why you want to apply for this course, whether you apply to the right course, so that's the personal statement. It doesn't have to be, 3 pages long. It can be a 1-page personal statement to explain why you want to apply for this course. And then generally, it requires 2 references. It can be from your teachers or someone who actually knows you very well, but not your parents, not your relative. But someone actually know you very well, okay?
Right.
Teachers, or you've been working before, and then the manager, perhaps the supervisors, could actually provide you with a good reference that says about you as a person, okay? And then the academic report. Academic report. If you're applying for a university, we would expect you to have the high school like SPM, IG. The kind of academic reports ready, or the foundations or the A levels academic reports ready in order to apply for a university degree. And lastly, English qualifications is also very important. That's because the medium of instruction is not in Chinese nor in Bahasa, it's in English. Therefore, having good command of English is very important. So you've got to have either IELTS, TOEFL, PTE, or certain universities do have a set of acceptable English qualifications, such as 1119, O-level English, and IB English. So it actually depends on the respective university, but generally, IELTS, TOEFL, PTE are widely acceptable. Okay?
Phenix, I think there's a question here. Let's jump to it because this is relevant to what you're saying here. The student is asking, this is from a private messenger, is personal statement important in an application? Would it affect the application acceptance?
It does, actually. Right. It does, actually, because the admission tutor does read your personal statement. So to understand the person behind who make an application, they want to see your insight about the course, whether your expectations on the program, does it match with what the course is offer? And the worst case is that we wouldn't want to see a student applying for the wrong course.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I want to study law but end up with a business and don't know about it. So the personal statement is the one that actually will help the admission tutor to understand why the students, you know, is best fit for the course. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Phenix. So we hope that answer your question is important. So put it in. Okay. You do not have to do a personal statement. Don't worry. Come to see me. I'm Jeffrey. I will help you. I'll give you some sample. Okay.
Yes.
Anyway.
Yes, personal statement. How to write a good personal statement.
I think we have some samples in the office that they show you how some of the students previously how they wrote it. Some of them are really good. Okay. Anyway, thanks for sharing us on about the UK and about the UCAS. I mean, I know, but time is not too permitting for me to tell you more detail, but come to see us at the office. We were more than happy to tell you more. Come to JS Study or come to Study Hub office in Klang and Ginger Room. We will help you. Okay, Phenix, since you said that UWE is in Bristol, why don't you also start to introduce to us what is there about Bristol that you can share with us?
Been really honored to be your guest tonight, Jeff. I've been doing a bit
no
of
worries.
Homework, you know, putting some slides together. So I'm going to be, and it's Saturday night, as I mentioned earlier, so everyone going to be chill and relaxed and whatnot. So I'm going to be a tour guide to take you through Bristol, through a few slides and then with a clip. Is that okay, Jeff? Hello?
Definitely.
Yeah. So let's
move on. Of course.
Well, we start with the map. Still the map. Okay. This is the red. You can see that, you know, the circle, that's where Bristol is, and then at the right hand side you can see that that's where London is. So the distance from London to Bristol is just merely 90 minutes by bus or by train. So it's not far at all.
That's right.
Malacca
to KL.
Yeah, exactly. That's the distance I always describe to my students. In Malacca to KL, within 2 hours, then you are in London. Within 2 hours, you will be in Bristol. And not only that, accessing to very famous city aside from London, I mean, people who has been visiting to the UK aside from London, they would definitely visit to Bath. And Bath is just one train station, about like 15 minutes away by train from Bristol. It is, but Bristol is better.
Definitely.
Okay, right. I mean, it has its own charm, by the way. So in the southwest, Bristol is the biggest city. And then going to other places like Cardiff, which is in Wales, it's only within 15 minutes away. Going to Birmingham is like 1 hour, 20 minutes. And then Manchester is a bit further away for footballers, you know, football fans and all that. So it will be 2.5 hours by bus or by train. Okay. Let's move on. So just another few facts about the city. It has a lot of green spaces. And for Malaysians, especially for girls, we love shopping, and there have been so many places for you to shop in Bristol. No worries about that. Then a lot of music, like, you know, a scene, for it can be a concert, it can be in pubs, and then a different kind of music performances in Bristol, something, you know, that you might like. And then various kinds of food available, from street food and then to something Asians as well, or international cuisines and British food as well. So a lot of different kinds of food available. So not to worry if you will get your nasi lemak, you will get your Chinese takeaway and whatnot. So not to worry about that. A lot of culture and art and culture scene as well in Bristol, which later on I'm going to show it to you. And throughout the years, especially during summertime, on a usual year, not the COVID year, they do have a lot of and they also have this international airport, which is just about merely about like 35 minutes from the airport to the city center, very near. And they have railway stations, coach stations, which is in terms of transportations and commute, Bristol has its own advantages. So it's quite convenient to accessing to the rest of the UK by fly or by train or by bus.
But sorry, I just thought about it. The students who are coming to study in UWE, they will come through London Airport, right? And then they will take a bus.
Yeah, normally they could actually fly from KL then to London, okay? That's the international airport Heathrow. So most airlines do have a flight from either a direct flight or a transit in somewhere and fly to the UK and land in Heathrow Airport. So most of our students actually will choose to land in London. But nonetheless, if the students is traveling alone and feel more comfortable to actually, you know, I don't want to have too many transits and, you know, so they can actually take a flight with KLM, Royal Dutch, and then from KL to Amsterdam and transit in Amsterdam and then fly to Bristol International Airport. It's possible. But the number of flights, number of airlines that fly from KL to Bristol is limited. It's probably just Air France and KLM that have this daily route. So not many. But again, if the students actually land in Bristol International Airport, is very convenient. Just half an hour in a cab or in a bus, then you are in the city center or in your accommodation already. But if you actually, you know, fly to London Heathrow, again, it's not difficult. You can actually join our meet and greet service, and then you hop on to the bus, and within 1.5 hours, you'll be at the university. And if you stay in the university accommodations, you'll be at the university accommodations within 2 hours. So it's pretty convenient. Not to worry about that.
Sorry, you can just go on. Sorry to interrupt you just now.
So it's COVID time. Most of the flights can't actually take off. So we are, I'm going to take you to Bristol through this flight. Just bear with me. So that's the Hot Air Balloon Festivals, which is a huge hot air balloon festival. So that's because of the manufacturers of this hot air balloon, David Cameron, I think. He actually owns the company, and then he's from Bristol. So he runs this on a yearly basis. And on the right side, you can see there's a bridge, which is a hanging bridge. This is a very famous Clifton suspension bridge. It's the world's first hanging bridge. And it is in Bristol. It's sort of like the icon of the city. And there are a lot of street arts, murals in Bristol as well. So, just the Clifton Suspension Bridge I mentioned is the world's first hanging bridge and whatnot. So it was actually like built in 19th century. A guy, a civil engineer, you know, those days people are very, very clever. Do you think so, Jeffrey? Mathematicians at the same time, and then they are scientists, and then they are also philosophers and whatnot. So this is what happened. The guy who actually create this bridge, his name is Isambard Kingdom Brunel. He's a civil engineer, okay? And then he actually has the inspiration to create this, build this bridge. So it took like 37 years back in 19th century and to complete the whole bridge. So you can actually take a walk. I mean, nowadays you can still take a walk. It's about like more than 200 meters. You know, it allows cars and also pedestrians to actually cross the bridge. And the depth of it is actually less than 100 meters, but it's still very, very deep. Yeah. So built above the river called 𝐅𝐮𝐧 River. Okay. The same guy, that's the guy at the right hand side. The handsome man. He is the one as well who actually built the world first iron steam ship. So what you are seeing here, this is the replica, and this is a museum of it. It's still there in Bristol. So this guy, he had because all the time, in the past, the ship were actually on the steam. And then he was the first one who actually made the iron steamship. So, and this is the one, So he's really clever. And then the ship is actually aimed to, what is that called? To sail from Bristol to New York. Yeah. Mm. And then the same guy also built the great railway from London to Bristol. So it was, a really, really clever engineer, determined, and make all this happen. Yeah. So if you notice that from London to Bristol by rail or by bus, it's the same hour, same time, 90 minutes.
That's right. I wanted to ask you earlier on. I noticed that you put in 90 minutes by rail, by bus, by
yeah. Well, for the bus, we can understand because you can always like pave the highway, correct? Mm-hmm. So with rail, it's a bit more challenging, and back in 19th century, can you imagine? Mm-hmm. So he is the one that actually like making all the measurements and making sure that it's actually taking the shortest route from London to Bristol. For his effort, now that people travel from London to Bristol, they have a choice whether they want to take a train or they want to take a bus. But obviously, usually the bus ticket will be much cheaper compared to the train because it fluctuates, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, right, let's move on. I mean, this is what is it called? The SS Great Britain, which is the first iron steamship. It's a museum. There's a 3D virtual kind of, you can actually check on the YouTube and just have a look at how is it like back in 19th century, people actually who work and live inside the ship itself.
The ship, interesting.
Yeah, so, and you can even dine inside as well, have dinner. Very interesting.
Okay, I'll work very, very hard so that I make sure that our team get to go there.
Well, during non-COVID time and, you know, flights and stuff some helicopter view of Bristol. This is a river actually cutting through Bristol, and then this is one of the scenes, very pretty. This is the Queen Square. Mm-hmm. Near to the river areas. I mean, as you can see from the screen there, Bristol was actually been voted as the European Green Capital. So that's because of the efforts from the government, the Bristol City Council, the schools, the NGOs, all companies as well, all put together their efforts in making a Bristol a happier and a more green and sustainable city. As a result, they've been awarded.
Must be a very beautiful city, I said, you know, because I also love a lot of green stuff, you know, in a city.
On a good sunny day, then it will appear to be nicer.
Of course,
because UK always gloomy, right? Always. Yeah. Bristol Europe, still
I think yeah. I think the most of the Europe is that.
Yeah, quite true though. Quite true. I mean, we are blessed with having sunny day all year round here. Whereas in UK, a lot of time they have gloomy days. But summer has been good. Hopefully, this year has been good. Yeah. Okay, let's move on. Why am I showing you this? Okay. All right. Now, in Bristol, there is a very very famous graffiti artist. So his name is called Banksy. If some young students, you probably have heard about Banksy. He was originally from Bristol, born in Bristol. But the thing is, he has remained really mysterious. Nobody have actually seen him before. So he's quite a one kind of character, artists, they always rebel. So he actually overnight, and then his artwork actually appeared somewhere in Bristol, and then there were more than about 10 pieces of his artwork actually in Bristol. Some are still there, some actually been damaged, or some actually moved to the museum. And this is one of those very very famous and still there. It's called the Hangman. And his work always criticizing something in the society. And his work, some of his works are still in Bristol. Each of these has got its own stories, and his work usually will be sold at very expensive prices. And then there were more than 50s of his artworks scattered around the UK, but a lot actually are in Bristol. But aside from Banksy, a lot of murals appear in the building, outside of a building in Bristol. You can actually see it while you're there. And then someone actually described Bristol as the city whereby it has the most murals in the world.
More than Penang.
Definitely more than Penang. But Penang, because the buildings are usually, you don't really have high rise, correct? They do have some high rise in the city center. So some of these the facade of the building itself is already painted with mural, which is different. So, and then other artworks from Banksy as well, which can be found in Bristol. The right hand side is a Grim Reaper. It was also from Banksy. What happened? This is actually, he drew this on the Tekla. Tekla is a pub, and it's a ship itself. So he literally paint this on the ship, the outside of the ship, and people keep damaging it and all that. So to avoid it to be deteriorated, so they have actually put them in the museum now. So so it's in the Bristol Museum. Okay, wow. Then we move to Bristol Museum, but I'm not going to show you fancy works here. I personally love to visit the museums in London. And then also in Bristol, it's really, really fascinating. A lot to see, a lot to learn. If you're a person who learn something in the past, the museum it has got a lot artifacts, dinosaur bones and stuff like that. I can spend the whole day there. And it's free of charge. So you don't pay any entrance fee and whatnot. Both in most of the museums in UK, they don't charge. So you give a donation, but it's up to you whether you want to donate or you don't. So So I mean, just in case you are students, after your maybe in the weekends or something like that, or after your classes, you've got nothing to do, but might as well visit to these places, museum or library and places like that. Something to do aside from attending classes. Okay, we all love food, and I picked St. Nicholas Market. It's a kind of a local food market with varieties of food from Europe, from fusions and locals and whatnot. So, it's just like a Saturday afternoon today, you know, this afternoon, and then you got nothing to do, and then sit down, enjoy your breakfast or brunch with a cup of a cappuccino and a toast, and just to watch the day.
So nice.
Yeah, I know.
If the weather is good, that'll be definitely very, very nice, you know.
Yeah, it is. I mean, they it's covered, so not to worry about that. So, I mean, to us, UK is cold all the time, so just make sure yourself actually covered, then you'll be fine.
Yeah.
The first market, again, these places are on foot in a sense that you can actually walk there in a city center without, like, you know, travel far away. I mean, in 10 minutes you'll be here and 10 minutes you'll be there, you know, it's just a nice place to be.
Yeah.
And the Bristol. I mean, in the UK, every place has got a lot of churches, cathedrals, and whatnot. I put this in here. This is a 12th century cathedral, and to encourage our students that if you do well and you succeed in your and pass your degree, and you'll be graduating in this beautiful cathedral, and your parents will be very, very proud of you.
Yeah, fantastic. So beautiful.
Yeah, so the UWE's communications is actually conduct in this Bristol cathedral. Okay. Right. Well,
Asian food.
Asian food. I mean, just in case, you know, we miss Asian food. Like some of my colleagues, they can't take British food for too long, so they must have our Chinese cooking, for example. It's not a tourist place. The Wong's Chinese restaurant. I mean, plenty of Asian foods are available in Brussels, so not to worry about that. Okay. And they can even do buy Asian grocery in Bristol quite easily. Halal meat, no problem.
Shopping,
yes. So a lot of places for shopping. So the brands available in Malaysia, in London, it's also available in Bristol. What I mean is that Padini is not there, by the way. You know, but those like H&M and those youngsters preferred brand, they are all there. Brands and things like that. So they are there. So you don't have to pack your bag with a lot of bajus and bring that. So don't worry, because there's always Primark to rescue. No worries, because it's even cheaper than in Malaysia, and you got a lot of good deals. Okay, right. I talked so much about Bristol. Let's visit to Bristol in 30 seconds, okay?
All right, let's go.
Welcome back.
Welcome back. Definitely welcome very back. Interesting city. Yeah, very interesting. I think it's rich of, it has got very rich history, culture. You know, like what you say, you know, it has got, I think UK has got this thing where it has got a lot of strong culture, rich in heritage, you know, and all this. Yeah, I love the church, I love the cathedral that you mentioned just now, you know, fantastic architecture that you mentioned, and so delighted that you share with us a bit about all this, the city of Bristol. But anyway, just to ask the audiences, not to forget, if you have got questions, we are going to talk about UWE now, but if you have questions to ask, feel free to put it in the comment box. I got a student who asked for scholarship. Hang on there. I think we will talk to you about the scholarship. But anyhow, feel free to ask questions over here. Okay, Phoenix, you may continue. Yeah. But thanks for telling us about the city. Why don't you also spend some time to share with us about your university? I think this is the main important of the of the show that we want to know what has got UWE got to offer to us.
Sure. Thanks, Jeffrey. I always actually share with students that, you know, picking a university, yeah, study in the UK, you know, choose the right course, and then but then again also your students' experience is also very important. If you have both, that would be fantastic. You have good education. At the same time, your students' experience are very much enriched. You know, you have great students' experience, so that would be great. So if UWE has got a course that is at your choice, you know, please do consult JS Education about, you know, more information. Okay, UWE Bristol stands for University West of England. Okay, for students who actually who have studied in UWE, they will call it UV, then or sometimes like ourselves will call UWE or University West of England. They are all the same. Okay, so some of the highlights, the achievement of the university. We are a TEF Gold University, meaning achieve the grade A for teaching excellence framework, which I will explain to you slightly later. And then, in terms of a national student survey, this is NSS. So to it's governmental, whereby students conduct the survey. This survey is actually conducted by the government for the students, and then the students are like the clients. They are they happy with the course being taught, delivered? Have they received enough of support and whatnot? So, and throughout that NSS survey, UWE actually ranked number 7 in England, so which is very high. So the satisfaction is very high. And then, as you may know, just in case you do not know, that in the UK, there are close to 140 university in the UK, 140. Mm-hmm. And then UWE is actually ranked top 30 in the Guardian University Guide. Yeah. So our chancellor aimed to actually, you know, get the university ranked in top 20 in 1 or 2 years' time. Very ambitious.
Wow. And I think it is achievable. You achieve it. You will achieve it. I have confidence in you.
Yeah, thank you. And it's a TEF Gold University. It's governmental. It's not run by any newspaper surveys and league table and whatnot. So, as I know, there are just 1/3 of the university in the UK have this TEF Gold status. So, and UWE is really proud being one of the TEF Gold University. So, how they actually assess this is actually based on the kind of support, teaching and learning that the university provide to students, and then in ratio to their achievement, whether they can get a high skill job right after they graduate, or they pursue their studies right after that, as a benchmark, and also the student satisfactions throughout their studies with the university. And also in UWE, we give very personalized support to students in supporting their study journey. And as a result of that, students actually achieve very high employment rates, or they continue on with their studies. And that actually being part of the reason why UWE has achieved a TEF Gold status. Yeah, and we are very, very proud of this achievement. Yeah, because some of the even research university, so-called high-rank university, might not actually achieve the TEF Gold status. So you can actually use this as one of the benchmark in selecting the university. Yeah.
Cool.
So you get very good support during your study. Okay? Right. Some overviews we have. Close to like 30,000 students study with us, both full-time, part-time, international students. We have got 17% of international students, which is about like close to 2,000 international students are studying with us from more than 100 countries. And then Bristol has been voted as the number one city in the UK. That's based on Times 2017. Yeah.
The people actually voted Bristol as the best city to live in 2017.
Oh. Yes. Wow, no wonder.
Yeah. I mean, as usual, you like to live, work, and receive education in a better city, correct? So, and Bristol was actually voted as the best city to live in.
I'm sure that it is one of the safest cities in UK per se.
Yeah, safety is one of the benchmark as well. So, and generally, Bristol is it's quite safe in general. Right.
Okay.
So, and we were also selected as number 6 for postgraduate top students experience. Okay. Mm. The rest are like TF goal. We rank top 30, and 94% of our students actually get a job right after their degree or pursue their studies. So, mm-hmm. Okay. So some of our courses are highly related to employment. All the courses are actually prepare the students for their future careers. And then we must also mention about our GradLink. GradLink is actually a platform. It's an online platform that powered by UWE. And then the team behind this, David Gies and his team, has been putting a lot of efforts throughout the years, many years, in putting the UK students and graduates, international students and graduates, is a platform allowing them to apply for jobs, and then the employers as well to sort of meeting the students and then to find the talents. And then, so hundreds and hundreds of students actually get jobs through the GradLink program.
Great.
And also some highlights about this. I picked this, the University Enterprise Zone. It's in UWE, whereby it allows students who like to have startup, who has a brilliant idea, innovation idea, and it has to be technology related. Okay, so it can't be any kind of business. It has to be a technology savvy related kind of business idea. And then and the university enterprise zones will allow the students to actually run their startup, to support them as a startup in the university for a year, and it's free of charge. So they get the support necessary. You know, they don't have to pay rents. They don't have to worry about, you know, whether they have a copier, machines and laptops and whatnot. So because it's all actually being supported through the university enterprise zone.
Wow.
The guy in the center, I can't remember his name now, but he was the one actually, he was our robotic graduate. He actually created a very interesting robot games. It's an actual games that is now actually sold to Apple Store. Yeah.
Mm. Wow.
Yes. He was one of the recipients of the user of this university enterprise zone. Okay. So that's the university enterprise zone, which is located at the UWE Bristol Robotic Lab. Okay, that's the cafe area and the surrounding. That's where the business incubators are. Okay, and also international students. You can actually gain various kind of experience, work experience through the International Talent Program. It can be internship, it can be placement, it can be some work opportunities while you're studying, and also volunteering work as well. So, it's very, very important for students nowadays to actually gain as much work experience as possible, because that will wow your future employers. Okay, let's move on. So, and that's the campuses. Yeah, we have a few campuses around in Bristol, and Friendship Campus will be the main campus, and most of the courses like business, law, education, engineering, architectures are all being offered in Friendship Campus. And Glenside Campus will be mostly on the healthcare related, like physiotherapy, nursing, you know, that kind of programs will be offered at Glenside campus. Anofini, Spike Island and Bower Ashton will be mainly offering the creative industries program, like graphic design, animation, fashion, journalism, media related kind of programs are actually city campuses. Okay, so some views of the Frenchay campus. It's a huge green campus, just 12 minutes bus ride from the city center. So we don't really have high-rise building because we have that kind of big landscape. You know, have a big green campus too, and you know, it's good exercise for our students really. And we also have on-campus accommodation as well. Yeah, in the Frenchay campus. So this is the business school, and it's a brand new business and law school actually.
Yeah, beautiful campus you have there. Looks very high tech.
Yeah, it looks great. There's a video. Is that playing? No, not really. So there's a video, I think. Not sure whether.
Yeah, Phenix, the video was played just now. We managed to play it on the campus. Phenix?
Okay, let's just carry on. Okay. Shall I actually stop sharing from my side so that the video can go on? Or how,
oh, the video, how does it work? We showed the video, Phenix.
Sorry?
We managed to play the video, no problem.
Okay. Perhaps you can play it for me then.
Oh, we have already done that video. Sorry.
Okay, great. No problem. Then I'll just carry on with this. Yeah. Okay, thanks, Jeff. What you have just seen was the Bristol Business and Law School. It's a fantastic building, 7 stories. It's probably the highest, tallest building in the whole Frenchay campus, brand new. A lot of modern facilities, contemporary places for students for discussions, and there's a cafe there, which is my favorite. You know, and then moving on, the Bloomberg Financial Trading Room. It's also a plus for our business school, whereby students, you can actually get Bloomberg certified by taking up the course. A certain hours of Bloomberg training, you can assess the Bloomberg system for breaking news, updated news, and you can actually analyze the historical data and then put in some data into the investment environments. And what I always tell students is that you will learn the experience, but you won't actually lose any money. So you are actually in a very safe environment while trading in the Bloomberg Financial Trading Room. Okay, Moot Court, we offer we've been a law providers, education providers for a long time. We offer LLB, which is very popular among Malaysian students. The bar as well. So they will be using the Moot Court as well. Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's where the so I should skip this video, right? I should because it's already played. Okay, let's move on to campuses. Yes, Bower Ashton is one of the city campus that offer our creative arts programs, the graphic designs, the illustration, animation, fashion, that kind of courses, filmmaking courses are actually offered in the Bower Ashton campus. It's a very beautiful campus, which is my favorite. because the landscape itself is the location itself is actually on the near to the Ashton Court, where you can see green pastures, and on a good day you can actually see a lot of deers actually come near to you. So it's just the kind of environments that you like to be in.
Yeah, that's right.
And this is the brand new digital media studio for our filmmaking students. Fantastic facilities with really, really high technology studios and equipments and laboratory. Yeah, so I think this is a 3D printers. We have got a lot of fantastic equipment to use. They can learn new and then they can just sign up the workshops and they'll get trained to use these facilities. It's the 3D printing printer. So a lot of workshops available within the faculty itself. So apart from like computers, they will be using a lot. So they can also like explore and learn other skills through these workshops with UWE. Okay. And then the equipments, like the whole studios that you can see in the center of the picture, they are all cameras, various kinds of cameras and equipment. Yeah. And they're really expensive. Our students, they come to us to join the course. They can actually loan these equipments for free for, you know, more than 2 weeks without anything. Yeah. And then the cameras and the facilities are just state of the art. Right. So the audio galleries and whatnot. So move on. We have the Glenside campus that offer a most of the healthcare program. This was a previously a hospital setting itself, and now it's a university. Yes. So the previously it looks, was a hospital.
Yeah, that's why I thought how come it looks a bit more heritage feel for this campus. Right?
Yes. Yeah.
But it's beautiful. Yes. It's beautiful. Oh, looking the hill behind you. I can see a green hill.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a very nice campus. You know, just the kind of like expectation from my Asian students. Oh, I want to go study, and that's the kind of universities in our, you know, our imagination. How a British university should be look like, and Glenside really resemble that kind of image. Anyway, this is just the outside of it, and I must actually say that. The interior itself is actually modern. It's actually modern. Mm. So you'll be studying in a modern environment. You have lecture theaters, you have all this equipment. So it is fine. It's very nice.
That's right. It's beautiful. Wow. I should go back to my young age.
Same here. You're still young, Jeff. You can come and do a master or a PhD.
Maybe do a master's there, 1 year program. And then my family, how? All go along with me.
Okay, so that's the four faculties that we're having. Joint running like more than 400 courses, range from creative arts, education, environment, technology, engineering programs, architecture, business and law, healthcare, and so on. I mean, moving on will be just, you know, some course title that I will probably just throw around and showing you the kind of courses that we are offering. These are some of the very popular courses amongst Malaysian students. They come
to us. Which are the programs that are very, I mean, the Malaysians would really go to UWE for? Will it be almost every one of it? Yeah.
Sure.
Business program is one of the famous ones.
Right. Malaysian students are, I mean, they come to us for business, for law, and creative arts programs.
Architecture as well.
And then, some of them, they come for engineering programs, architecture.
Right.
Our architecture programs are highly ranked. It's ranked number 6 in the UK. I mean, when it comes to high rank, programs, then the seats are always limited. So they only take very, very keen and very good students. And we offer part one for part one and also part two programs as well. The course is actually recognized by our Lembaga Architect Malaysia. So yeah, you can actually choose to come to UWE for part one, or you complete a partial, you know, complete a part one equivalent programs in Malaysia, and then apply to UWE for your part two, which is MArch. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
So computer science related courses as well. Yeah. And games technology is a big thing in UWE, very popular. Health and applied sciences related courses like physiotherapies, paramedic, psychology, and so on. So a range of all kind of business and law programs we are offering. So we also have like on-campus accommodation. So I always tell students the class starts at 10 o'clock. You can wake up at 9:45 and still be on time. Not to worry about that.
Don't encourage them this way. Wake up at 8:50, 8:30, have a breakfast. I know you're trying to show to them that it is so near, right? It's just within walking distance.
It's very near. Yeah. So we have ensuite, like also like, you know, shared bathroom. And students nowadays are very particular about where they, the type of accommodation. So so we have various types of accommodation for students to choose. Okay. So some of the entry requirements, just to let you know, we accept students from STPM, IB, various kinds of UEC as well, and other types of qualification. Yeah, depends on the entry points. Okay. And I mean, as a foreign university,
I think one of the students asked about this question as well, Phoenix.
Yeah, earlier on. There was a student asking, we offer various kind of scholarship. Being a foreign universities, I think we are very generous in terms of our scholarship scheme. So various types of scholarships are available. Yeah. Do actually inquire through JSA Education if you have any questions, because we can actually look at what type of scholarship is actually best that we can actually award to students. Okay? So like alumni, if you are one of the UWE alumni, if you apply to study with us for your master's degree this autumn or next January intake, you will receive a 25% of scholarship discount.
Wow.
Okay, that's a lot of money. Yeah.
Yeah, so, definitely a lot of money.
Yes. Other than that, if you are one of the offer holders, meaning you have a conditional offer or unconditional offer with UWE, we even have other types of, you know, a contest that is going on towards the intake, whereby, you know, you write an essay and then submit in, who knows that you actually win an additional of £1,000 of scholarship on top of what you have already, you know, received. Yeah.
All right. Okay. Very well.
And then this is going to due very soon. Deadline on the 30th of June, whereby let you know, who knows, next year we are going to do the same contest or some kind of similar contest again, whereby we know that, you know, not every student's you know, academically brilliant, but they are doing something else fantastically. It could be they have some talent, and it could be they can take a very good videos and things like that. Okay, so then we actually have this like a video contest. The best videos actually will win £7,000 of a scholarship to study with us. Okay.
Yeah.
So again, ways to apply. There are various types, you know, to apply to UWE, and this is it could be through directly to us, it could be via, like, you know, Asian representative friends like JSA Education, UCAS, and so on. Okay, that's about it, Jeff.
Okay.
So our Facebook page, we have a Facebook page, and tonight we are doing live as well. JSA Education and Study Hub Facebook and UWE Bristol Malaysia Facebook page, so that we are stay connected. Okay.
Yeah. That's right. Thank you, Phoenix. Right. Thank you for your precious time, your explanation, you know, very detailed. I see the way you share, You know, one thing I can summarize one thing about you. You have shared to the students and audiences with a lot of passion. And I think that is great. You know, you speak from experience. You know, you can tell that you have been there. You know, you really have been there. You know, sometimes it makes a difference when you're talking it with passion and you're talking it for the sake of talking it. So thank you very much for that, Phenix. But there is a question
No problem.
But there's a question here, just a final one. This question, but okay, this one maybe. Okay, what is the fee if study in UK for 1 year? I think she's talking about chemical engineering or psychology. Yeah. So I think you have got that earlier on.
Right. The tuition fees per year is approximate about like 13,500 for this year and next year. So that is the published university fee. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, you might need like a £10,000 for living costs, which inclusive of your accommodation, food and whatnot, as per year. Yeah.
Okay.
So it's about 24,000 pounds per year that you need to put in your budget. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Phenix. I think just to summarize it, the student who asked this question, you may come to our office. We will tell you more about the fee. Of course, if you ask about UK or Australia, definitely Australia is more expensive. No matter how you put it, you know, living expenditure as well as the tuition fee, it will be more expensive than UK. But do come to us, we'll share with you more on that. Okay, Phenix, thank you again for your time.
For having me.
I know it's almost getting very late.
I'm behind time.
Bye. No, it's okay. I think it's no problem. You know, sometimes we have it and appreciate you coming, spending your time. We love to see you again, hopefully, in other events that we may have. And what can I say? Oh, yeah, one thing. You know, you had that contest video for the students to do it. Let me suggest you do one for agency like us. You know, I'm quite sure Study Hub, we can do a very good creative video for you all. Who knows, you may give us a free ticket to go to visit UWE.
Why not? Just to put your leg.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. That's a good idea. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, students, and whoever actually watched in front of the screens. Thanks for having Jeff and myself. Have a good Sunday tomorrow. Yeah. Bye.
Okay, bye, Phenix. Okay, everyone, just to again to share with you, thank you very much for joining us. We're going to have to sign off now. I'm Jeffrey. Do stay tuned, like our Facebooks for other programs that we always offer to you passionately to bring to you different countries, different programs, different universities, local, abroad, just for you. And stay tuned, share out all this information. JS Study Solutions, Study Hub, Student Advisory, you know, we are here to help you. Take care. Have a good weekend. Jeffrey and Phenix, we are signing off. Bye-bye. See you again.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Karina, and welcome to Bristol. So I'm currently a BPTC student at the University of West of England, Bristol. And I'm at my last stages, finally. And here are a few things that I think would be helpful for you guys. So studying from home has been a real challenge for all of us. You know, it's something so new to most of us, and it's been a really difficult time adapting. Personally, I found it to be quite a learning curve. You know, we're not used to not having our classmates around us, not having our lecturers in front of us. But during this time, the university has done its best to make sure that we are not disadvantaged by everything that's happening around us. This has been done by moving classes online, and that has been really helpful because the lecturer, you still feel like the lecturer is in front of you, your classmates are virtually around you, and the environment is almost exactly the same, apart from the fact that you get to do it all in the comfort of your own room. But of course, you know, at the end of the day, a degree, a postgraduate, whatever it is, it's not just about studying, it's also about having fun. So here's a few things that I like to do just to wind down or to have fun. Let's go!
So pop-up study in my free time. I really enjoy being outdoors, playing a few activities, enjoying the British weather, just to keep alive.
But other than staying outside, you know, I found it really helpful to do other things that I like, such as baking and cooking. And this has really helped me with any homesickness or any time that I really just miss the food that I can only get back in Malaysia. You know, from an international student's perspective, I can understand that now is a very difficult time for all of us, whether you are still away from home like I am, or if you are already back home with your family. My advice is to take some time for yourself, find things that you personally like doing, you know, be in a healthier headspace instead of constantly feeling the need to be productive. And I hope that all of you stay safe with your families especially. I hope this video has been enjoyable for you. I know that I've enjoyed my time at UWE. And remember, UWE is ready when you are. Bye! Bye.